My name is Dr. Silvia Dal Bianco. I'm very glad to be here today chairing the first session of our teaching conference 2022. The topic of this session is increasing diversity in economics. And with us today, we have Caroline and Eileen. Before starting the session, I would like to have some housekeeping rules, to remind you some housekeeping rules. We have here, well, they are on the screen now. The session will be recorded and uploaded to YouTube. Live transcription is enabled. And if you have any questions, please type them in the Q&A functionality. We will try to monitor the chat as well, but in terms of questions, we really prefer to have on the Q&A. So having said that, it's a pleasure, as I said before, to have Caroline and Eileen with us. So similarly to what has happened before, I will leave each of our guests to introduce themselves and their topic, and then we will have a discussion at the end. Thank you, Caroline, if you want to start.
Wonderful, and I'm going to do that. Always challenging moment of can I share my screen successfully? Let's see. And share my slide. Yes. All right. Are we seeing? Yes, I succeeded. Good. Wonderful. Good. All right. Good morning from Minnesota, everyone. I'm Dr. Caroline Kraft. I'm an associate professor of economics at St. Catherine University here in Minnesota, and I'm also on the advisory board for the Minnesota Center for Diversity in Economics. And it's with both hats, the sort of teaching hat and the Minnesota Center for Diversity in Economics, that I'll be talking to you today about some research we've been doing on gender and racial representation in online K-12 economics lessons. So this is some work I've done with the MCDE, the Minnesota Center for Diversity in Economics team, and super appreciative of all the efforts everyone has put into this. So to start, why are we even focusing on representation in online K-12 economics lessons? We do know, we've been talking about already a little bit today, some of the issues in terms of diversity throughout, if you like to call it the pipeline, throughout the progress through economics education and through the professorate. So some sort of motivating facts on that: women are only 35% of economics majors in the United States, where I'm based, and only 18% of economics majors are Black, Indigenous, or people of color, BIPOC, in the US. And these are some of the problems we see sort of at the college major level. And there are a variety of reasons this may be happening, but certainly one of the things that doesn't help is that folks don't see themselves represented in teaching and learning materials. So for example, in college textbooks, female and BIPOC examples are very much underrepresented in college textbooks. And there's been some research on principles of micro textbooks. In addition, when there are examples, they are less likely to be economists, policymakers, or business leaders. They're less likely to be economics examples and more likely to be fictional examples or celebrities. So the sort of way folks are portrayed, we know has some issues in college textbooks. But this past research on representation in economics education materials has focused primarily on these sort of principles of college textbooks. But at least in the US, the time students often first take economics is in the kindergarten through 12 grades. So 58% of high school students in the US have taken a high school economics course, maybe just for a semester or half a semester, but this tends to be their first exposure to economics in those grades. And unfortunately, K-12 economics teachers do not usually have a degree in economics. In the US, high school social studies teachers is the certificate to teach economics. So you have to have a credential in that. But you usually take maybe one or two economics courses to get that credential. So these teachers average 1.5 economics courses from college, and then they're teaching high school economics. So they've usually had one or two principles of economics, or principles of microeconomics and principles of macroeconomics. So as a result, in part because of this sort of limited preparation in economics, these are teachers who frequently rely on publicly available online resources for lesson plans. So I'm going to be using some data from this website called Econ EdLink, and it has 1.2 million unique visitors per year accessing lesson plans and resources. So this is like a big population drawing on these online K-12 economics materials. So what we're looking at, the research questions we're looking at in this paper or presentation at this point, is to what extent are there female and BIPOC examples in K-12 economics education materials that are readily available online. We're also looking at in what roles are women and BIPOC folks represented. And then lastly, we're looking at how do author demographics predict who is represented in examples. So does who's writing it relate to who's included in the example? And so I'll tell you here our little hypotheses, and we're focusing for these on US K-12 economics education material available online. And I'll note these are our null hypotheses. We'll test them and reject, I think, most of them here. So the first hypothesis we test is whether the proportion of women examples is equal to women's share in the US population. And second, we test whether the proportion of BIPOC examples is equal to the BIPOC share in the US population. Third, we're looking at the roles. We're looking at whether the share of female examples that are represented as economists, business leaders, or policymakers is the same as that of male examples. So we're seeing the same roles. And likewise, whether the share of BIPOC examples represented as economists, business leaders, or policymakers is equal to that of white examples. And then we kind of test some of this demographics predicting what the examples are. We test whether female and male authors are equally likely to use female examples, and whether BIPOC and white authors are equally likely to use BIPOC examples. So I already alluded a bit to this Econ EdLink data, and here's a little screenshot on this side here. It's from the National US Council for Economic Education, and it provides free online K-12 lessons and activities. So you can see there are quite a lot. There are 1,463 currently total lessons. And so we just did a sample of these. We sampled using a random number generator for the page and then the lesson on the page to get a sample. And for each of the lessons we sampled, we coded the race, gender, and role. So whether it was a real person or a fictional person, and if a real person, what profession? So were they economists? Were they a celebrity? Were they a politician? For each example. And so we sampled 160 lessons. But lessons sometimes have more than one activity or more than one example. So within these lessons, there were 354 examples where we could code gender. So you can see this was a random grab from the website, but I feel like this is a great screenshot. You can see Princess Persephone loses the castle there. So like we can tell Princess Persephone, we can code the gender of that one. And then there were 249 examples where we could code race or ethnicity of the example. We couldn't really code some of the fictional examples, but for real people, we can code those. Andrew Jackson or LeBron James, these are real people, and we can code race and ethnicity. And then there were 347 where we could code what role the person was based on sort of the story or who they were in real life. So those are the outcomes we look at. And the key covariates we're looking at are we coded the author race and gender. For organizational authors, that was not applicable. But there were 342 examples where we could find who the author was and code the author's gender. And for 302 examples, we could identify and code the author's race. So I'll note here when I'm doing the analyses, when I talk about female author, that's going to be female author, lead author, or a mixed gender team. And BIPOC author is BIPOC, or the team includes a BIPOC member. So when I use those, that's what I'm referring to. Our methods are pretty sort of straightforward test these hypotheses. To test the share of examples female or BIPOC versus the US population. It's a one sample proportion test compared to our latest census data. Testing the share of professionals within examples, whether that's equal for male versus female or BIPOC versus white. That's a two sample test of proportions. And then testing how author demographics predict sample demographics. We run some linear probability models we look at whether as a dependent variable, example female is predicted by author female, and likewise, if example BIPOC is predicted by author BIPOC. So turning now to the results, I'm showing here some just descriptive statistics on gender and race of examples by authors, and then we tested the hypotheses, and I'll summarize that from the text. So you'll see here that 23% of the examples, 23% of examples where we could identify the gender were female. So that's versus 51% of US population, and we reject that hypothesis that there's population level representation. Women are very much underrepresented in these K-12 lessons. Likewise, BIPOC examples are 16% of examples versus 40% of the US population. So again, we reject sort of population level representation. And for the author characteristics, these will be coming up in some of the models as well, but if the author is BIPOC or even if the team includes a BIPOC author, that's only 20% of the examples. And very, very few were actually BIPOC solo authored, like a countable number on my fingers. And then in terms of author female or mixed, that 61% had a female member of the team. In terms of the results on gender, race, and roles, so up here we're looking for female examples and male examples. We're seeing the distribution of the roles the example had. So for example, for females, 55% of the female examples were fictional. So it was just a fictional named female, Carolyn is running a small business, that kind of thing. Male examples were only fictional 18% of the time. And indeed, when we test that hypothesis, female examples were economists, business leaders, or policymakers 21% of the time versus 61% for male examples. So we reject the hypothesis that they're equal roles. And likewise, the BIPOC examples below were economists, business leaders, or policymakers 44% of the time versus 74% for the white examples. So we again reject equal roles in terms of race and ethnicity. And for the race classifications, we couldn't classify the fictional. So that's why those numbers are a little higher overall, but there's still this huge disparity. And in fact, one of the things I will highlight is that in our sample, there were zero BIPOC economist examples not. Turning now to our results on author demographics and representation in examples. So here the first piece is whether a female author predicts a female example. And female authors are significantly more likely to use female examples. So we reject that they're equal chances by author gender, but it's still not enough to reach gender parity, right? Like there are, what is this, 11 percentage points more likely to use a female example, but that's still not even 50-50. And interestingly, BIPOC authors are not more likely to use BIPOC examples. However, I'll note that as I mentioned earlier, there are very few BIPOC solo authors. So there may be some different composition really going on when we break this down. So those are our results. I'll own a few limitations and also point to some interesting directions for future research. One of the things that we were working with the MCDE research team, and they worked very hard to code the examples and the authors, but this was challenging work. Some cases were clear, in other cases it was subjective judgment. Is this author based on their photo? White passing, that was something that is of course subject to judgment if we couldn't find any information that they self-disclosed on race and ethnicity. Some cases also were gender neutral, and I say this in quotes, sometimes it was an example with an animal. Research interestingly suggests neutral materials are often interpreted as male and white, even if it's an animal, for example, but that was a challenging aspect of coding. And I'll note we had data really from only this one source of online US K-12 lessons. Findings could really vary with other sources and in other contexts. And it's a question for future research, you know, are these materials more or less representative than other sources? We have a representation problem in these materials, but are they actually better than written text? Still bad, but better than written text. Are they better than online materials for higher education? So these are some questions we may work on in future research. And there's also not much research assessing the impact of representation in K-12 materials on student perceptions and persistence and economics. There is some at the college level. At the college level, for example, no female role models increase women's persistence in the economics major. But that's an area we don't really know as much as we'd like in the K-12 space. So to pull together the results and sort of think about some items for action here, really our key finding is that women and BIPOC examples, as well as authors, are underrepresented in K-12 online lessons. Now, interestingly, the 23% female examples that we see in these K-12 materials is pretty close to what we see in college introductory textbooks. And interestingly, women authors are more likely to create female examples. So for folks who are teaching, for professors, really it's a good call to consider who's represented in your materials and work to be representative. One of the things my department has done is we've done syllabus audits where we check like who's on the syllabus, what authors are represented, and we've also looked at our teaching and learning materials, and this is a great actually student project to review teaching and learning materials and see who's represented in our podcasts, in our examples, in our slides. Folks who are creating these materials need to consider who is represented in their materials and work to be representative. And one thing I'll put a plug in for sort of personally is writing open access materials and textbooks that are representative. So it's easier than you think, although it is still a lot of work. I, for example, got really pissed at our intro econ textbooks. And so I wrote a new one, Economics for the Greater Good, an Introduction to Economic Thinking for Public Policy, that's publicly available as an open access resource. And I made sure 50% of the people I cited were women and sort of worked through that process. And also you can think about promoting, supporting, funding. If you're a department chair, you could put a little funds towards this, diverse authors and diverse materials. So those would be kind of the plugs for folks to work on from the takeaways from this presentation. And I'd just like to thank the Minnesota Center for Diversity and Economics team for all their help with this project as well. And thank you. I'll look forward to the discussion after Eileen's presentation.
Oh, thank you, Caroline. This was a really, really interesting presentation and very interesting, even a little bit sad distribution we have seen so far. Just a quick clarification point. I think this might help the discussion later on. Doug was asking how widespread is the use of the resources you have analyzed so that we can have a better idea on the possible audience and possible effects of this biased vision of the profession.
Sure, so 1.2 million unique visitors per year use the Econ EdLink website that these materials are on. So they're very commonly and widely used. I wanna say something like 2/3 of economics high school teachers say they use online materials like that they Google and find online in sites like this, more so than written textbooks, actually. Yep.
Okay, so thanks a lot for the clarification. And then we had quite a few questions, but as we agreed, we are going to leave them for later. Now, Eileen, the floor is yours.
Great. So I'm now going to share my slides. Right, so here, so I'm Eileen. I'm a senior lecturer at the Queen Mary University of London, and I also work for Core Econ, which is an international initiative that promotes sort of innovative, develops and promotes innovative teaching and learning materials in economics, which I think some of the audience will be familiar with. And this is a joint project that I've done with Inez Lee, who's at the University of Cambridge, was a junior research fellow. So I think it's actually quite coincidental that my presentation follows off of Caroline's, because she was mentioning about how people should increase the diversity. And then here is sort of a practical initiative, a project that Inez and I have been working on to create these kinds of materials and find these examples that lecturers can use. So I'm going to be discussing that today in the presentation. So the project that we embarked on since sort of January 2022 was to produce a set of undergraduate teaching materials that serves two purposes. And the first one is to incorporate underrepresented perspectives and economic topics. And the second is to highlight the contributions that researchers from underrepresented groups have made to the field of economics. So I don't need to go into any statistics, so Caroline has already done that for me about how there's a representation problem in economics, not just gender, but in different forms of diversity. So with underrepresented, I'm using this sort of term to cover you know, gender, race, region, and also non-neoclassical perspectives as well. So what we did is we mainly did it for the University of Cambridge, but we were identifying key gaps in inclusion and representation in the current Cambridge economics curriculum. So the way we did that was we did some surveys of their undergraduate students there. So at Cambridge, the students, there is a sort of a pure economics degree. So they do like really focused economics for all 3 years. So we interviewed, and we also did focus groups on these and students from each of the year groups, and we surveyed all three year groups as well about what they think about of inclusion and representation in their curriculum. Based on the survey results, we then identified the gaps, and then we co-created a set of these teaching materials with undergraduate students from underrepresented groups. So we asked for volunteers, and then they helped us create these teaching materials. And what do I mean by these teaching materials are we have reading lists for specific topics, and we have case studies from different countries, and we also have examples as well of different, which highlight the diversity of research that's been going on in economics. So these are just some survey results. So we asked them many more questions than these, but just to highlight the main question, which was how balanced do you think your curriculum is in terms of race and representation in general? So we have a very large mass to the left here showing that most students don't think that it's very balanced in terms of race and representation. So we actually did get a lot of students to fill in the survey. So it was 177 students, and 56% of them identified as Black or Asian minority ethnic, and 37% identified as female. So that's roughly the demographic you would expect for the in terms of gender of what you would expect in a typical undergrad econ course. So they basically don't think their curriculum is very balanced. And in terms of the solutions, so we presented a few different solutions to them, and they did think that this was the strongest response. So they thought that it would be very valuable to have case studies or examples from regions outside the UK or the global north. So in terms of the focus groups and the qualitative survey responses, we identified three issues. So the first was that the Cambridge curriculum is too focused on British and other Western economies. So at Cambridge, for example, they do a compulsory first year model, which is called British Economic History, and it's exclusively, as the module name suggests, about the economic history of Britain in the past, from the 1900s to sort of the 1970s. And they also have a module in modern British politics. So there were some international students, not from the UK, they lack the context of, you know, how Parliament works and how all these parties interact, and so they found it difficult. So I don't think this problem is exclusive to Cambridge. In general, courses that are taught in the UK might tend to focus on examples that are in the UK, but also other Western economies like the US. We also found that the students thought the course was almost exclusively theoretical neoclassical economics. So there was very little discussion of behavioral economics or even climate change sort of being presented as an externality and then kind of left it at that, despite being one of the biggest policy issues in the current society. So when we asked students about what kind of learning experiences they found to be quite positive, so like, you know, thinking on the positive side now, what did they find inspiring about their time at university? And there's this Cambridge Society for Economic Pluralism, where they have speakers who come from different, they present different perspectives on certain issues, and it's sort of an optional activity, but students identified these talks as being some of their most interesting learning experiences. And so this was sort of a free text response. We just asked them what you think, and then a lot of them were saying this. And then quite a few students had comments about the diversity of perspectives and authors and reading lists in particular could be improved. So these were some of the issues, the key issues that they identified. So in response to that, we hired some student interns to help us create some materials to fill in this gap. And I'm going to go over some of the resources that we've created, which are not polished yet, but it's just to give a preview. So we did create some features. So these are just short biographies of over 40 economists, both current, contemporary and historical, from underrepresented groups who have made significant contributions to economics. So these are short biographies that lecturers, if they're, we designed all of these materials so that it's very easy for people to implement them in their teaching. So it's not like you have to do a whole lecture on, you know, gender or feminist economics, but more of if you're teaching a topic, you can sort of slot these slides or a short biography in, like, oh, here's someone who's also done some really great research, and then you can kind of, so yeah, so it's not required, lecturers are not required to sort of do some whole structural change of their curriculum, because they do tend to be quite married to the material that they're already teaching, as we found. So here's an example of a short biography. We do have longer ones as well, but this is a short one. So Carmen Reinhart, so I'm sure that you know, many people have heard of her, but students have surprisingly not heard about, of her. She's not mentioned very much, at least not in the Cambridge context. So aside from giving a brief description of you know, who the person is and what contributions they've done to economics or policy making, we also have some readings. So in case students are interested in following up. And we also have other examples, so not just female economists, but we have Andrew Brimmer. So he was the first Black governor of the Federal Reserve. We have Anna Schwartz. She's done work on macroeconomic policy with Milton Friedman, but she didn't receive a Nobel Prize along with him. And M.V. Lee Badgett, who's studied economic cost of homophobia, effects of discriminatory laws and the LGBT community, and has served as an expert witness in numerous legal cases in the U.S. as well. So trying to get the whole spectrum of diversity here. So that's one of the resources we've created. So we have lots of economists to mention. We've also compiled a few useful resources in terms of reading lists and lecture materials. So these are slides that cover the role of history in modern economic outcomes. So this is one topic that has sort of been pushed to the forefront lately with, you know, Black Lives Matter, decolonizing their curriculum. So sort of acknowledging the role that historical laws, policies, and customs or colonial relationships with other countries affect economic outcomes. So financial outcomes, economic development, health, education, and other forms of inequality. So, you know, the legacy of what's happened in the past is still present today, and acknowledging that could help some students identify more with the material. So one example that we have is the legacy of colonial medicine in Central Africa. So again, we have longer descriptions of the papers, but we also have some sort of short abstracts as well. So this was about a paper that's about the French colonial governments, where they had forced medical campaigns in Central Africa. So basically millions of patients were given these medications, which had really strong or fatal side effects. They didn't know the efficacy. And then they also had, like, they also spread disease through the use of unsanitary needles. So basically, they found that regions that had been exposed to these campaigns have had lower vaccination rates and lower trust in medicine specifically. So that undermines the effectiveness or success of the World Bank health projects today. So it's kind of, you know, the history is affecting people's attitudes towards medicine today. And we have other examples of these. So we have at least 20 different papers. So for example, the long run effects of the scramble for Africa and also Peru. So we really try to get different regions. We have here, we have some examples from South Asia, from India and other countries as well. And also the experiences of people who are living, of minority groups who are living in Western countries, like labor market discrimination in the UK and in the US as well. So in terms of, we've created other resources. So for world economic history, so I've briefly touched on historical experiences, but here these focus on non-Western countries. So economic experiences of people in countries that had been colonized. So while the, so one example of the of papers that we found here were the colonial and post-colonial changes and impact on pastoral women's roles and status. So basically, this was the effect of colonization in northern, of the women's status in the economy and labor market in northern Kenya. So again, we have like short blurbs. So these could always be incorporated as part of a reading list or briefly discussed in lecture. And finally, we have we've just non-capitalist economies, so both past and present. So we have case studies. So just, some students mentioned that it would be interesting to learn about what's happening in countries that are not capitalist economies. So we gathered some readings and examples as well. So one example being monetary policy in the Soviet Union. So when monetary and fiscal policy are discussed, it's always in the context of a capitalist economy. But just to give students some more breadth of understanding about what happens or what has happened in the past, here's a short blurb, again, that we wrote, that's one of our interns wrote about how the Soviet Union used to conduct its monetary policy. So they had this hybrid institution called the Gosbank, as shown here in the picture. And it actually fulfilled the roles of both the central bank and commercial banks. So we have these descriptions as well. So we have some of the Cuban economies as well. We have Soviet Union and other non-capitalist economies. So those are the four kinds of resources that we created. And so now we have next steps. So our project is still sort of in progress. So we do plan to publish these materials online. And we are going to hold a workshop at Cambridge to publicize the materials so the lecturers can use them for the 2022-23 academic year. We're also planning to work with departments at our respective universities to use the materials as part of outreach programs for secondary school students, because there's a lot of misperceptions about what economics is about. And also in terms of the materials that we show the students who plan to apply for these programs, if we can show them that the programs have good representation, you know, they can see themselves in the examples, then they might be more likely to choose economics as well. Yeah, so that was my presentation, just summarizing what we've done and what we plan to do. So if you have any questions or you would like to contribute in any way or have any further examples, you can always write to us using this email. I've just provided my email here. So that was it for my presentation.
Thanks, Aline. This was very, very interesting and inspiring, I have to say. I have first of all a clarification question, as we did with Caroline. Well, the question is about the first charts you have shown us, and some of us were wondering if the responses changed by the year of study, by ethnicity, or by gender. So if there is a homogeneous perception among different types of students of the diversity that is embedded within Cambridge curriculum, basically.
Yeah, so we didn't do sort of formal regression analysis on these results, but we did find, we didn't find very many systematic differences across the gender or race. So for example, white students, whose students who identified as white were as equally likely to think that their curriculum was not representative compared to students who did not identify as white. And similarly for gender, I think they generally acknowledged that it was an issue, and it also came up in the focus groups when we talked to. So we did have focus groups made up of students who were both minority and non-minority and underrepresented. We didn't really see many differences in the opinions. I mean, they did have some idiosyncratic opinions, but nothing systematic.
Okay, so there is no systematic difference. It seems quite well spread in the Cambridge students community, this kind of perception.
Yes, and we think that's possibly because the two modules which we mentioned were the British economic history and politics were taken by everybody, so they would have that sort of same perspective. And they don't have that many choice, especially in the first year, in the kind of modules that they choose. And then the second and third years, they did acknowledge that they were able to choose modules which had sort of elements they were interested in.
But can I ask, when are you going to use, or how are you going to embed this kind of material? You mentioned four types of resources. At which stage are you going to use these material you have created, these resources?
Yeah, so our plan would be to talk to the lecturers of the different modules. So first publicize the materials and ask them whether they would be willing to adopt them in some form. So we did identify those two modules as being ones which could have the most improvements, where if you could bring things, when you discuss, for example, the Industrial Revolution in the UK, you can also sort of linked to a paper which discusses how other countries were developing or how other countries have achieved similar levels of economic growth. So we don't have a clear prescription as to where they should go. I think just publicizing them for the lecturers to decide which parts they want to adopt and where to put it in, because I think adoption, it requires the lecturer to be willing to change their material. So we're just providing it there, and then they have different options.
Yes, I think this was a point that has been made in the chat and in the Q&A with respect to both presentations, because Caroline has shown us that this kind of lack of diversity is quite embedded before the student get into university, and it would be very, very important to act promptly to be able to change the pattern that Caroline has shown us well before they get into university. And to this respect, we had one question about some groups that might feel particular pressure for these changes to happen. And this question is for Caroline. Do you think that like women or minority groups, indigenous groups you mentioned, are particularly in demand of this kind of change?
That's a great question. I think there's certainly research showing that the students who are underrepresented, including women and like BIPOC students, feel less relevance, belonging, and have less of a growth mindset, for example. Amanda Baer has done a nice paper on this, so that these students feel less included, and that can affect their persistence subsequently in the field. So I think there's a particular need, and there's evidence, like I mentioned, showing women role models affects women's persistence in economics. So there's evidence there. I don't think there's enough evidence. I would say to Eileen was talking about all these great things you can do. And it seems like an amazing opportunity to maybe run a randomized controlled trial with some high schools, pushing out these materials and seeing, what is the impact on these students? Does it make a difference in who ends up in the economics field?
Yeah, so related to that, Eileen, did you think about doing a little bit, linking to what Caroline just told us, are you thinking about doing a little bit of outreaching activities with school kids? Because this might be the good timing to have them thinking about economics as an inclusive subject.
Yeah, so I guess the difference between the UK and the US is that in the US, the students, when they reach university, they can still explore a little bit. And then if they took their first econ course, they didn't find it fun, then maybe they'll choose something else. Whereas in UK, we're dealing with students who already kind of chose economics. And so in terms of outreach, I do agree with what you said. It should be done earlier. And it would be, yes, I do plan to use these materials, at least in my universities, outreach programs to high school students. In terms of involving other secondary schools more broadly, like for example, the Royal Economic Society has some initiatives for like Discover Economics, trying to get to reach students earlier when they are starting to choose their subjects to study. So possibly I am considering working with them as well. So there are other initiatives that we could sort of latch on to. Yeah.
Thanks. And passing to the perception of students, you've shown us the results from a survey of economics students, I guess. So, there is one question about the experience these students, the experience of economics these students had before getting into your course. So do you know whether they had studied economics in high school and how the way they did study economics before might have influenced their responses? Did you think about that maybe?
Yeah, so I think Cambridge students tend to be a more homogenous group. Most of them have taken A level. They have taken quite similar A levels, so math and probably economics as well, to apply to Cambridge. So in that sense, they would have been quite exposed to economic concepts and mathematics before coming. As to why they had chosen to study economics, so we didn't ask that in the survey question, but a few students did mention that some elements of the courses that they were taking were not exactly what they had expected. So they were, for example, quite surprised to be learning about British politics and about British economic history. And so they were, I think they had expected to learn about more than just about the UK and Europe, for example.
Okay, so the well in so there is for sure some sort of memory about what economic is and the expectations that students have when they come to university. So I think that the conversation in the chat before was about trying to change these sort of expectations. And there was one comment about the possibility of do not fall into tokenism that might alienate some students if we use them like a sort of a stylized examples. And then there is talking about the future. The first question is for Caroline. And it comes from the Q&A. And we all noticed the results presented were a little bit sad, but not unexpected. How do you think this state of affairs can be improved?
Well, I think one great thing is Eileen followed me and showed some examples in teaching and learning materials, particularly that you can improve. But there are also things you can do. And as the point about tokenism mentioned as well, you do have to make structural changes as well, right? Like it's not a just one thing. There are a huge number of things that need to be done that together may help increase inclusion in the profession. So things like role models, things like structural changes like prerequisites and how you do math requirements. That's a big one in the US in terms of the math requirements, how they're structured, and whether you support people versus are trying to kick people out of the major. They're very different philosophies in different places about whether you're like, yes, math is fun and challenging, and we're going to figure out how to do it versus this very fixed mindset of you're bad at math, you shouldn't be an economics major, that we see a lot of issues around that. You can do things about what classes you require. So you can require, and we're working on this at our university, we're working on what's called a critical studies or an anti-colonialist or a women's studies course as part of the economics major, like a cross-listed one, right? I teach international economics and we include a lot of discussion in terms of anti-racism when we're talking about immigration, and in terms of colonialism when we're talking about trade, particularly as well as immigration that comes up as well. So you can do some intentional things in your curriculum and your course requirements. And then one of the ones that was really cool that Eileen had mentioned was these sort of community talks. We've done things like debates where we present things from several different perspectives, rent control, socialism versus capitalism. The students love these. They talk about these a lot. Bringing in diverse seminar speakers to talk about their research, particularly helpful at small institutions who may not be able to cover a variety of topics. That's a great way to get people in. So those are just some of the things that we've done, and I've seen evidence on elsewhere. There's a lot of evidence, for example, at least at the PhD level, on the importance of mentoring programs and how that has an impact on careers.
Okay, thanks. And Eileen, you have mentioned a lot of resources you have developed to help diversifying the curriculum. We have here a question about the communication of these resources to colleagues that maybe are less sensible than the ones present to this conference to this kind of issue. So did you plan a sort of communication strategy to let people know about all these resources that are, well, that might, they look quite ready to be used?
Yeah, so we are planning in the next coming few months to publicize these resources, just in case people are planning to use them for the next academic year. So all the attendees just keep your eye out for them. We'll try and I do have some networks in the UK that I'll be emailing, sending out notifications. But also, if there's any others from the US, I don't know the US networks very well. But if I could reach them, then that would also be great. Yeah. And with regards to colleagues being on board with adopting them. Mm. I think we did have it in mind that some people did mention tokenism, and there could be, you know, the pitfall of people just, you know, putting some diverse people in the slide and then like briefly mentioning them and moving on. And I think that the key to embracing these kind of diversity and inclusion in economics is the implementation, right? So even if you briefly mention certain people, if the lecturer is able to communicate that their contributions to economics were really meaningful, then even if they are just briefly mentioned, you know, due to time and time constraints in the lecture, then the students will still have a positive experience. So in the focus groups with the students, we were talking with them and they already said, oh, you know, we have so many readings already, the lectures are really packed. So, but you know, if the lecturer did mention a few, like, oh, if you're interested, here's some readings on some other perspectives, they would have appreciated even just that little bit. And with all things, you know, when there are some resistance, if people will be willing to just start with a small change, not saying that that's the only change they need to make, but sometimes just starting with a small change and then seeing that the students are responding really positively to that might make people more encouraged to you know, do a bit more in that respect.
Yes, there is a lot of discussion in the chat about really having some good tips for quite resistant colleagues about thinking on how to think about diversity in economics and to change their teaching quite in a broad sense. Do you have any tip? Well, both Caroline and Eileen, do you have any suggestion?
So one of the things we found helpful was just doing a sort of department-wide, so it's everyone, review of teaching and learning materials and syllabi. And you can do this if you have the power within your institution to sort of push this happening department-wide, that may help people see, oh, actually my materials aren't that representative. There are also tools that help with this. There's the gender balance assessment tool that you can use on syllabi. I'll put the link in the chat for everyone. So there are existing tools that can help with that kind of work. I think, and this is optimistic of me, but economists, we're relatively empirical. So showing the data sometimes helps resistant colleagues, saying like, look, you know, here's the data on relevance, belonging, growth mindset, the impact of diverse role models. And look, you know, your textbooks, your readings are you know, 95% male. Maybe you could make some progress on that and setting goals around that as a department, assessment goals, things like that. I think we've tried to build those in, but it does require enough people in your department with enough power and interest in doing this to make that happen. When you're the only one, you can only really do it for your own courses at that point.
Thanks. Eileen?
Yeah, so the point about inertia is a really important one. So you do need to have some colleagues who are willing to take the first step. And I think that would help when I think the colleagues who are more resistant first need to see other people do it first and then see that it works well before they'd be willing to do it. a related point was, so some people thought, so I remember having a conversation with some people in my department, and they thought, oh, you know, it's not that big a deal in their course, at least, you know, diversity not being an issue, because they do like econometrics or something, or they do macro and all the data is in the US anyway. So why do they need to find any other examples? So another path that this project is hopefully going to take is to publicize data that come from other countries, just so they can't say that there's only the data that they need from the US, because there's, you know, there's lots of initiatives like Our World in Data nowadays that they collect these data from other sources. So really very little excuse if you don't want to discuss other countries. So just making them aware of all the resources that are available, because, you know, there's always switching costs. And if you can make those costs as small as possible, like, you know, providing the materials for them if they want to put it in the charts and everything, then that would help as well.
Yes, it is very true that it is helpful to be helpful in this sense. I'm personally working on the inclusivity for the overall student experience, and I'm working with to minimize the BME awarding gap at UCL Economics Department, and we have found that there is a big role for the hidden curriculum for our students, so they don't really know how to learn and how to do well, the way in which they learned in high school or in previous university experiences in other countries is not very helpful in our UK system, because we put critical thinking at the top and then they do not know what critical thinking is, and this might generate some difficulties to them, and we need to support them, of course. And with this respect, I'm wondering if your projects, your work, has triggered already some broad thought. So in the sense that how to make not only the curriculum, but the overall student experience, the life of our students more diverse for the good. So do you have any thoughts about that?
So I think I mentioned a couple of things already, but I can talk about them a little bit more that we do. Mm-hmm. One of the things we recently started is a cross-generational female mentorship program. So there's research on mentorship, particularly later in the profession, like in PhD and onwards, about the importance of mentorship. And so we wrote a small grant, got the funding to do a small mentorship program that connects high school students, introductory college economics students, upper level majors and alumni. So they form little teams, and there's a whole amount of activities and programming. But that's one where you can kind of see the career progression, talk to people who've done it, learn from people who've, you know, gone through economics and enjoyed it, their excitement, how they tackle things. And this has been particularly helpful. So I'm at a women's college, and so we're doing these sort of teams as support and helping people, you know, go on to the PhD, and have had this support and this group who's sort of cheering them on, and they're cheering each other on. So building those networks in some sort of structure has been something we've tried, but we haven't had enough size or budget to really run an experiment and see the impact, but the anecdotes are positive. So we're hoping to figure out how to sort of scale up that mentoring. There's also a lot of research on student spaces. So what we call like nests for students. So we have, with much institutional toil, actually, we now have an economics research lab space. When we have student research assistants and students who are working on class things, a space for them to be able to meet, to hang out. It's for research, but it's also designed to be a supportive space where we have people there to help you with your problem set, right? So that they're like friendly, they're usually recent graduates that we're hiring for the economics research lab manager role. Things like that have been anecdotally very helpful for, and there is research like backing up NEST and mentoring in general for building a more inclusive space. particularly when you staff them with students, right? Our student body is 50% students of color, our research assistants in the lab are 50% students of color. They can see each other, they can see mentors in that space.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Eileen?
Yeah, in terms of the overall student experience, I can share a few examples of from my own teaching, just because there are other more structural issues with the, you know, the kinds of lectures that the students see or the student demographic who applies to economics and their classmates that I don't really have control over. But in terms of improving the student experience for the students who do come in and they're in economics, there's been a lot of discussion in the chat about letting students contribute their own examples. And I also think that's really important. So for example, giving them projects where they can write about a country they're interested in or policies they're interested in, and giving them validation that what they're doing is actually like valid and interesting to study. So it's not just like if you're studying other countries, that's important too, and you don't have to study the UK or other Western countries if you don't want to. So letting them bring their experiences into the course is very important.
Yes, I think that this is, well, both of you have just underlined the importance of having students on board while bringing their own experiences and also to lead in a sense the diversification of the discipline boosting diversity and inclusivity in the discipline. We are doing in our project is along these lines. Well, our students are making proposals for change. So that we have a sort of student representative representing minority groups that are leading some initiatives for making our economics course a more inclusive place, especially for minority groups, but not only for them, because we want to be inclusive for all our students and to have a positive impact on all our students. And so far, I'm amazed because the response rate these students had with their survey is astonishingly high. So that I found that if I try to do something, I'm much way less successful than a student asking other students to answer the questions. So it might be a very good way to involve students for change and make economics diverse and inclusive. Let me see if there are other punctual questions.
Yeah, I can just add a couple other examples. Yes, sure. When you're looking for questions. So one of the things we did, the comment about econometrics reminded me of this actually. Oh, it's econometrics. Like, why do you need to think about inclusion? But one of the things we did with one of our econometrics courses called quantitative impact evaluation is we did community engaged learning. So we've done this with a variety of different community partners. But the students are actually doing data analysis like for a client, for a community partner. And we've done this on things like working with the Center for Indian Country Development, working with the city economic development and planning, working with a housing provider that tackles homelessness. And students find it very engaging to have something where they feel like they have a client, they're delivering for someone, they're helping solve a social problem locally. And that has been, I think, particularly rewarding for students. And we've done something similar called Data Fest, which is like a weekend where you kind of dig into a data problem with a community partner with students across the spectrum of sort of like high school students, college students from different majors, economics majors. And that's been particularly effective in making students feel like they can do the quantitative things when you see students who have been told, oh, you can't do math, and they have a lot of math phobia. That has been one that's been particularly powerful, I think, for getting students excited and engaged and persisting in the field. So I'll drop some links on that.
Thank you. And I have a question for both. When we invite, or we would like our colleague to make an example that is diverse, this might be difficult because us and our colleagues might be not that familiar with this kind of diversity. Do you have any suggestion for how to handle this kind of difficulty? And
so, I mean, you know, you can point them to Eileen's resources once they're available. I think another one in the US is DivacQ. There are existing resources for most, like at least intro courses and increasing numbers of upper level courses, there are already existing resources. And the AEA, the US Economics Association, has resources. I think someone already dropped this in the chat, Diversifying Econ, right? So that's one that has a lot of these kind of resources. More info on our professional groups. Yeah, this is on their website too. I'll just drop the link to the MCD website. It describes our cross-generational mentoring program.
Eileen, do you have any suggestion?
Yeah, so I think just showing them examples of good practice. So if you know somebody in your department, or if you know like a colleague who has done those kinds of, and have like some examples like lecture slides or, you know, like videos of their lectures or other teaching materials you could show them. Because I think sometimes the obstacle is just they don't know how to do it in a way that, you know, so if you give them examples, then they can see how to successfully increase the diversity of their teaching materials.
Okay, and then we have another theme coming out, that is hiring advanced undergraduates from diverse groups as teaching assistants. Did you think about that, or do you think that this should be somehow favored and sponsored by some institutions, such as, for example, the American Economic Association, to facilitate as a facilitator for this scheme?
I don't know if like the American Economic Association would necessarily hire teaching assistants at a university specific level, but there are a lot of programs. So like the American Economic Association has a summer program for folks from diverse backgrounds who are interested in doing the PhD to get some additional both mentoring and preparation. So those kind of programs, Research in Color has something similar. The Sadie Collective does a lot of great work in this sort of mentoring and preparation space as well. So I think there are a lot of organizations that are doing work to try to increase representation and give folks who are facing a lot of challenges extra support to try to help them overcome some of those challenges, as well as address some of the underlying structural issues. I think on the university level, it really varies by institution. We have what's called the assistantship and mentoring program, where you can put in a little proposal each semester to have a teaching assistant, a research assistant, or a program assistant. And what you put in for is kind of like you can propose a variety of things. So if what you're proposing is, you know, a research project, an audit study, maybe looking at discrimination, that may attract more diverse students to apply to that position. Or if the teaching assistantship position is helping diversify the curriculum, that may particularly attract students who are excited and committed about that. So that's one way I think to tackle it, is to put some of your time and effort towards it and pull in institutional resources to complement that.
Eileen, do you have any thoughts about senior undergraduates from diverse background acting as mentors or teaching assistants for more junior undergrads?
Yeah, so I think in general, it's a good idea. At my institution, Queen Mary, we don't specifically hire students from diverse backgrounds, although the Queen Mary student population is around 70% minority ethnic. So they do tend to come from the minority ethnic background, but we do have we call it a peer assisted study scheme. So they're not necessarily teaching assistants, but they do have the sort of, we group third year students who've done the course with first year students. And it's kind of, you know, as the study scheme suggests, they kind of help, they help tutor them. So it's more of an informal thing. But I do think that this kind of scheme, if the institution were to hire the students from diverse backgrounds, it would also be beneficial to the students. So I remember that when I was an undergraduate, I was an undergraduate TA, at an institution in the US, and it benefited me a lot. It was for introductory econ, and I do remember learning a lot. So it's not just beneficial to the first year or to the younger students, but it also benefits the mentors themselves.
Yes, it is something which is very similar to a win-win, isn't it? It is very good for everyone, also for lecturers, I would say, for everyone. And there is another theme that has came out, that is the access rules, the entry rules to university. It has been pointed out in the chat that if we want to be more inclusive and more diverse, well, entry requirements should be revised. Well, not maybe every year, but quite often, let me put it this way. What do you reckon about that?
And so one of the challenging things is at the university level, I don't have much control over entry into the university, although I could comment on some of the things that might help get a more diverse population into the university. But at the major level, that's where we have a little more control over course requirements, for example. So we've definitely had some discussions and some thinking about different pathways into the major. So for example, we have a lot of students, and anecdotally, public policy is often how women get interested in economics at our institution. So we're the economics and political science department. Students often come sort of wanting to address a public policy issue, discrimination, for example, right? And so they take one of my classes that's required for the public policy major is economics of social issues. And another one is that quantitative impact evaluation class. So then we try to hook them into the economics major as well in double major. We're big fans of double majoring at our institution. So there's some thinking to be done about, like, okay, how can you try to pipeline students from one intro class where they may not be thinking about an economics major and structure your majors in a way that helps make that happen. The road bump we tend to hit is with calculus-based courses and the requirement to take a certain amount of calculus. And one thing that's really tricky is that at least at our institution, and I think this is pretty standard in the US, the sequence in which calculus is taught is the econ parts aren't necessarily in one course, they're spread throughout. And then there's a lot of stuff that students, I can't remember, and my students do not need to know, like sine, cosine, derivative, like I can't remember those, no idea what they are. And my students don't need to know them. So we've talked about, do we need to do a math for economists class that's much more about like, let's just do a cost minimization from the start, let's do it applied so the students see this. Because that is one our students tend to particularly stumble over being economics major is the math courses, and particularly diverse students whose high school preparation, they're coming from a high school that was under-resourced, may not have been very good and very encouraging in the mathematics portion. So that's one we've been thinking about and talking about a lot. And if anyone else has suggestions, I'm always intrigued.
Ellen, do we have any suggestion or any thoughts about the entry requirements, which in some cases might be really tough for students of disadvantaged background? In the UK, we have this big division between state school and independent private schools in which economics A-levels is not just taught. So they have, sometimes they have A-star maths as an entry requirement. So it is making the life of some students very, very difficult.
Yeah, so in the UK, sometimes the choices that students make because the A levels, they only choose a few subjects, they can lock themselves out of a lot of university courses if they don't choose the right ones. So I think one step in the right direction is not requiring A level economics in order to apply for an economics degree. So as you mentioned, the state schools are much less likely to have economics in the first place. And I think that, you know, anecdotal evidence from colleagues is that students who have taken A level economics are not necessarily, you know, more knowledgeable in economics when they come into the undergraduate. They think they know, but there's some, you know, some issues. So they think they know more than they actually do. So, you know, taking A-level economics is not necessarily an advantage. But I think even with my students, they're not required to take econ, but those who haven't feel that they're in a disadvantage, even though they might not necessarily be. And I think to get them to perform well in the first year is kind of overcoming that barrier. You mentioned some math classes. So we do at Queen Mary, we do have like a mathematics fair for economics classes. And back when I was teaching at Oxford, we did have some math classes for students who felt they were kind of weak at the math to help them get up to speed with what's being taught in the courses. So I think those policies would go a long way in helping the disadvantaged students succeed in economics and also be just willing to apply for that in the first place, thinking that they can meet the requirements.
Yes, well, entry requirements are a really tricky issue because, they don't usually depend on lecturers or teams, but they depend on colleges and, policies are quite a high level thoughts sometimes. We are coming to an end, and I wish to ask each of our speakers if they could provide just like three recommendations based on their experience and on their research for helping us as lecturers, but also our institutions and our departments to be more diverse and inclusive, what they would recommend.
So I guess I could start if Caroline to give her my time to think. So for me, the three recommendations, I think the first thing would be to sort of start with small steps. So, you know, for example, just start introducing a few examples. And I think as long as it's communicated that these are meaningful examples, not just tokenism, then that can go a long way already. The second is more of sort of thinking about when colleagues teach economics, they usually think about what they've been taught and they kind of think, oh, that's the way that I was taught. And so that's the way I'm going to teach other people. I think even for me, I had to think about, I had to be sort of step outside of my comfort zone and be, okay, I haven't taught this, I haven't seen this material being taught before, but I'm going to go for it anyway, that kind of thing. There's kind of that, and confronting any sort of implicit biases being the third thing. So when I was talking with the students who, when the lecturers sometimes had sort of implicit stereotypes or biases about different minority groups or underrepresented groups, that maybe they weren't aware of it, but it kind of got subtly communicated to the student and they felt a little bit uncomfortable. So I think everyone can do a little bit about thinking about the implicit biases that they have, and which could prevent the sort of effective communication of these sort of diverse material.
Thanks. Caroline?
Three is hard. I don't want to be just three, but I'll try. So I think one of the things both Eileen and I were pointing out is just look at what materials you're using, the teaching and learning materials you're using, the syllabus you're using. And if you realize, you know, you're a ways off from representative, you don't have to panic. You can work on it a little over time, right? Like each semester, swap in a few more examples, swap in a few more readings. if you're panicked when you see it and you're like, there's no way I could do anything about this and rewrite my whole syllabus, think of it more incrementally. And then in a few years, maybe you'll get there. I also think how you teach, so not just the teaching and learning materials, but like how you teach, is increasing project-based, increasing community engaged learning can really be very helpful. And the last thing I'll say for both of these is don't reinvent the wheel, right? Like there are already a lot of great materials. There are a lot of publicly available great materials. If you make great materials, make sure to share them, like stick them up on your website or find somewhere to send them to, like the Diversifying Economics Quality place. There are places you can share yours. So you don't try not to reinvent the wheel because that will make it a lot more efficient. And I know we're all time constrained. So my comments were a little bit like, how can you make this change? Well, time constrained. I think that's one way to tackle it is using great stuff other folks have already done.
Okay, thanks. So it seems encouraging from my perspective, because it seems that I should start very tiny, be a little bit brave and experiment and looking around for good stuff, isn't it? This is more or less the recommendations. And of course, we had great evidence today with Caroline about the fact that unfortunately the discipline is not as diverse and inclusive as we would like it to be, but great tips from Eileen, and we wish to be able to use them as soon as possible. So we will watch your spaces, and well, there are numbers of initiatives that are related to your work. Well, of course, in the UK, it has been mentioned in the chat, the Royal Economic Society Discovery Economics is one initiative that is targeting school kids. And then we have the RES Diversity Champions. Okay, so thanks a lot, Caroline and Eileen, for being with us today and for really intriguing, illuminating, and stimulating talks. And before leaving, I wish to remind you all that after the 5-10 minutes comfort break we are allowing to ourselves, there will be the first networking mixer session that is sponsored by Ed, and it starts at 6 p.m. The link is in the chat for this session, and I think it's in the email as well. Okay, so thank you all for participating today, and I will see you later. Thanks. Bye-bye.